Good morning, students. We start today with a fresh chapter of the main reader, chapter number 9, The Bond of Love by Kenneth Anderson. It's a story about the bond of love between a family and their pets. If I ask you, name some pets, the common animal's name which would come out would be a dog, sometimes a bird, or sometimes even a cat. But if I tell you, these people had a pet, a sloth bear, that would be very, very unique. And they shared a very special bond of love, which has been highlighted in this particular story. Let's read. Can there be love and friendship between human beings and wild animals? Let's read a fascinating account of an orphaned sloth bear that was rescued by the author. Sloth bears inhabit forested areas, including the tropical rainforests of India and grasslands at lower elevations. So you'll find them in low-lying areas. Even in India you find sloth bears. And they are found in the tropical rainforests. Sloth bears have very shaggy hair and long muzzles. Now that's the nose of the, we're talking about the nose of the bear. Shaggy over here means long, thin, unkempt. Like you would look at it and feel dirty. Using their claws to dig, they can then use their lips to form a tube which can go deep into the ground or into hard to reach areas like dead trees for their food. So they use actually their long mouth to suck out their food from the trunks of the trees or from holes. What do they eat then? Their main food is termites. You can hear them suck up their food from several feet away. So they, like a suction pump, they would use their mouth and suck out the termites. Termites is nothing but in Hindi you can call it dimak. So they suck up and they eat it up. So you, from feet away, several feet away also, you can hear that sound. I will begin with Bruno, my wife's pet sloth bear. Now I is the author over here. I got him for her by accident. It was not a deliberate action or an action which was planned. Accidentally, he brought that sloth bear for his wife. 2 years ago, we were passing through the sugarcane fields near Mysore. People were driving away the wild pigs from the fields by shooting at them. Now, wild pigs cause a lot of damage to the pigs. They dig and then they uproot the plants, and this thus they cause a lot of damage to the farmers. So they were being chased away from there by, they were being shot with a gun. Some were shot and some escaped. We thought that everything was over when suddenly a black sloth bear came out panting in the hot sun. Panting is running out of breath. So out of the wild pigs over there, they saw a black sloth bear. Now, I will not shoot a sloth bear wantonly, but unfortunately for the poor beast, one of my companions did not feel the way about it and promptly shot the bear on the spot. Now, the wantonly means no good reason. So, you know that the pigs were causing harm to your harvest, so you would kill the pig. But what harm could a sloth bear cause you? So, if the power vested in the author's hands, he would definitely not shoot at it, but his companion was not of that opinion, so he shot it. As we watched the fallen animal, we were surprised to see that the black fur on its back moved and left the prostrate body. Now, prostrate means lying on the ground facing downwards. So his face is down and you can see the back. So they could see an extra layer of fur moving on its body, the animal of the body of the animal which was shot. Then we saw it was a baby bear that had been riding on its mother's back when the sudden shot had killed her. So the bear was not alone. The mother bear had a cub which was clinging onto her body. The little creature ran around its prostrate parent, making a pitiful noise. Obviously, if the baby is going to lose its mother, it's going to be in a very pitiable state. So it was crying out for its mom. I ran up to it to attempt a capture. So the author wanted, actually with good intentions he ran, so that he could take away the bear from there to look after it. But the animal would not believe in any human. It scooted into the sugarcane field, ran away into the sugarcane field, following it with my companions. I was at last able to grab it by the scruff of its neck while it snapped and tried to scratch me with its long hooked claws. Now the scruff of the neck is actually the back part of the neck. Maybe an animal, it can be called as a it can be termed for a human as well. So from here the author could catch it. Because if the author's companions would get them first, then definitely you know what would be the end of it. So because the author was trying to grab it, to take care of it, but this animal was retaliating in return with its long hooked claws. We put it in one of the gunny bags we had brought when I had got back to Bangalore. I duly presented it to my wife. So he gave the gunny bag to the wife, saying, "Now here, there's your pet." She was delighted. She was happy. She at once put a colored ribbon around its neck. And after discovering the cub was a boy, she christened it to Bruno. Now, the wife was overwhelmed to get it. So she immediately took a colorful ribbon and tied around the neck of the bear, declaring that it is a tamed one, it's a domesticated one, it's a pet. And when she discovered that it was male gender, then she christened it over here, means actually giving it a Christian name which follows in the form of baptism. When you take baptism, the name is given. So she gave it a name, you can take it. And what was the christened name over there? Bruno. Bruno soon took to drinking milk from a bottle. It was but a step further, and within a very few days he started eating and drinking everything else. And everything is the right word, for he ate porridge made from any ingredients. Now porridge is a semi-solid liquidy food, made be khichdi kind of a thing, or kheer also would be called as a porridge, made out of any kind of ingredient. Vegetables, fruits, nuts, meat, especially pork, curry and rice, regardless of the condiments, and chilies, breads, eggs, chocolate, sweets, pudding, ice cream, etc., etc., etc. Condiments and other spices. The animal did not even mind the spice. It would eat away literally anything what was fed to him. As for drink, what would he drink? Milk, tea, coffee, lime juice, aerated water. Aerated water over here means soda. Buttermilk, that is chas in Hindi. Beer, alcoholic liquor, and in fact anything liquid. It all went down with relish. Relish is great enjoyment. Even liquor it would drink away with great enjoyment. The bear became very attached to our two Alsatian dogs and to all the children of the tenants living in our bungalow. He was left quite free in his younger days and spent his time in playing, running into the kitchen and going to sleep in our beds. So, till the extent a normal pet would be given freedom, the bear was given freedom, and it was liked by all. One day by accident, an accident befell him. Befell over here means an accident happened to him. Now, what accident was it? I put down poison, and the poison was barium carbonate, to kill the rats and mice that had got into my library. So because it would eat anything, now you can guess what could have happened. It ate the poison as well. Bruno entered the library as he often did, and he ate some of the poison. Paralysis set into the extent that he could not stand on his feet. So the barium carbonate left an impact on his body that he was attacked with paralysis immediately, and then he couldn't even walk properly. But he dragged himself on his stumps to my wife, who called me. So stumps are the lower portion of the legs, which will be working in a working condition after the entire paralysis effect. Whatever was strength was left in the feet, so that would be called, the latter part of the feet would be called over the stumps. So the wife was calling out to the husband, saying, "Come and see what has happened to him." I guessed what had happened. Off I rushed in the car to the vet's residence. So he was taken to a vet, the doctor, who cures the animals immediately. A case of poisoning. Tame bear. Barium carbonate. What to do? Now, this is actually a rare case. He would be getting all sorts of animals. A dog, a cat, domesticated animals. He would even get, might be, birds to cure. But a bear. Okay? A tamed bear. That too, case of poisoning. And what is the poison? That's barium carbonate. That doctor was totally stumped over there as to what to be done. What is to be done? Out came his medical books, and a feverish reference to index began. Now, feverish over here doesn't mean related to fever. Here it means it's an adjective. Something done with great excitement, very actively done. So he started referring to his books, what is to be done. What poison did you say, sir? Barium carbonate. Ah, yes. Barium carbonate. Ah, barium carbonate. So he's going on telling himself, this is the particular thing I need to look for the cure. Symptoms. Paralysis. Treatment. Injections of, just a minute, sir. I'll bring my syringe and the medicine. So he is cracked now, the case. He knows what medicine is to be given. So he goes, he runs away to fetch it. A dash back to the car, Bruno still floundering about on his stumps. Now, floundering over here means unable to move, with great difficulty is moving. The stumps I just now said what it was. But clearly weakening rapidly. So that poison was reacting in his body very fast. Some vomiting, heavy breathing with heavy flanks and gaping wide, gaping mouth. Now over here, flanks are actually the part of the animal which is between the rib and the hip. Okay, so there you could see that he was breathing rapidly, because once you run short of breath, your heart tries to pump a lot of air in it. So that's how that movement could be seen on his body. And the gaping mouth means the wide open mouth. Hold him, everybody. In goes the hypodermic. Now that's a long needle which goes right through the skin. That's the huge injection on, with it. A long needle on an injection. Bruno squeals, that pain, that voice which comes out of the animal is called squealing because of the pain. 10 cc of the antidote enters the system without a drop being wasted. So 10 cc was the quantity of the antidote what he used to cure the animal first. 10 minutes later, condition unchanged. Another 10 cc injected. 10 minutes later, breathing less, stertorous. Over here, stertorous means noisy breathing. The noisy breathing which was happening over there becomes less. So that means the antidote which he had given him has started working. Bruno can move his arms and legs a little, although he cannot stand yet. 30 minutes later, Bruno gets up and has a great feed, as he was very fond of food. He gets up, he eats a good meal, a good diet, as if nothing had happened any time. He was like, he just gets up as if he's just woken up from sleep and just wants to eat now. He looks at us disdainfully. Now this word means, you look at somebody as if they are so unworthy of being around. So like, he was like, why are you all encircling me over, surrounding me over here? And what has happened that you are reacting in such a way? As he meant to say with his body language, what's barium carbonate to a big black bear like me? Bruno is still eating. So that was the look he gave to the people who were standing around him, saying that what effect could barium carbonate have on a big bear like me, and I'm the invincible kind of animal. So the later half, we will discuss it in live lecture.